Good morning. Today, we're heading up to Ripogenus Dam and the Chisunka Boom House, up off the Golden Road. An area of a lot of logging, Maine history up that way. It's supposed to clear up. While waiting for that, we'll go make some breakfast. Okay, so we're going to have some breakfast to wind into us before we head up to Ripogenus. And we're getting pretty slim on food. Haven't gone shopping in a week. Although this is called my Nick Tahoe garbage plate breakfast. Leftovers, really. I've got some mushrooms and onions left over from a steak dinner we had. A couple of french fries I want to eat up. We're going to have some eggs and toast. Drive that into us for that drive up the Greenville Road. Greenville Road goes up over Sias Hill, past Ragged Lake, past Caribou Lake there. Heads into the Ripogenus Dam area. We're going to visit the dam. We're going to visit McKay Station and the Putting In Place. It's called the Putting In Place now because kayaks put in and some river rafters go out of there. That area there by McKay Station, you can park up top and walk down. And you walk actually around the hydropower plant. I don't know if you knew this, but I used to work at a power plant. I worked at a nuclear plant, a gas plant, a coal plant, and a hydro plant for a little while, way back when. So that's even interesting to me, just to see that hydro plant. The water that feeds McKay Station actually goes down through tunnels towards the roadside. You don't see those. They're underground. And I'll show you the doorway that leads to those tunnels. But when you go to the Putting In Place, you walk around the station behind the back and you go through a kind of a canyon area, falling rock zone. And it's kind of a neat place to see because historically, even the loggers, when they drove the logs down to the Ripogenus Dam area, they then took their bateaus and their boats out and went around the carry to what they called was the Putting In Place. There's some other cliffs there you can walk on as well. So anyway, I was saying, this is the version of the Nick Tahoe garbage plate where I went to college undergrad in Rochester, New York. It's a famous place called Nick Tahoe's. And you can get the garbage plate there with whatever you want on it. Usually macaroni, beans, hot dogs, baked beans, hot sauce, french fries. And they pile it all up on a plate. You choose what you want, and it's a garbage plate. You can imagine it's pretty popular at like 2 a.m. on a Friday or Saturday night after a night out. So this here is a camp garbage plate. It's the leftovers from the week. But it'll do, and I've got some oranges, so that's some healthy food. A piece of leftover bacon we'll throw in there. But it's supposed to be a nice day, so we'll see how the route is up over Sias Hill. And I'll tell you about old Sias, why that hill is named Sias, as we're driving over there. And you could find a lot of the information about that area of Maine in the Penobscot Man, Life and Death on a Maine River. This is a new annotated edition full of new stories, photos that were not in the original Eckstorm book that she wrote. And this book also has some lumberman ballads that weren't in the original, but also some never-before-told stories about the threat Fannie Hardy Eckstorm had from the renegade poacher Jack Russell. He threatened her life and her father's life, and Wilbur Webster was their guide and actually bodyguard on that trip. So there's a whole new story added in the book about that. We are on the road from Greenville to Katahdin right now. We're headed to
Ripogenus Dam and Chesuncook Boom House.
Well, stick around. We're heading up. We're where the Penobscot Man was written by Fannie Hardy Eckstorm, where those stories took place, where her life was threatened, hers and her father's. We were going to the Ripogenus Dam area. That's where Fannie Hardy Eckstorm went to do a lot of her research. Well, before she was Eckstorm, she was Fannie Pearson Hardy, before she was married, in her 20s. She went to the Ripogenus Dam area to document the river drive. That was the most famous gorge, Ripogenus Gorge, before the big construction of the cement dam by Great Northern. And in the year Fannie and her father went to Ripogenus, they first took a train from their home in Brewer, then a steamer across Moosehead Lake all the way up to Northeast Cary. From there, they canoed down through the West Branch into Chesuncook, down into Ripogenus Lake, and camped with the river drive at Ripogenus. Well, before she got there at the Chesuncook house, the Nova Scotian hide hunter renegade Jack Russell threatened to kill her and her father. And that was because Fannie Hardy Eckstorm wrote a series of essays in Forest and Stream on the game laws. In those essays, she was supporting the game laws. She called out the hide hunters and the poachers and those that were dogging deer, those that were going against the law. And the renegade Jack Russell said he was going to kill her father, Manly Hardy, and her if she came to the woods. She didn't know it at the time, but Wilbur Webster was not only their guide, but he was their bodyguard. But anyway, on the way back, there's some thought that because of the threat, they didn't canoe back the way they came to Northeast Cary and take a steamer back to Greenville for the train. They walked this road. They went from Ripogenus and the dam, and they couldn't really follow the drive down the west branch of the Penobscot because it would take probably 2, 3, 4 weeks following the drive to get ahead of them. That time of year, the water was really rushing a lot along the west branch, even to the lower lakes. And then in those days, even Millinocket wasn't there. So it was pretty rough country to get out to Nicketow and go down the way of Penobscot. And besides, Wilbur Webster was a guide out of Kineo, so he had to get back to his work there. We think it was because of the threat from Jack Russell, who was doing some bear hunting up Harrington Lake, Chesuncook way, and because of the threat, they came back this way. They walked. They left their canoe at Caribou Lake, or Webster's guide canoe at Caribou Lake, and they walked over this road. Now, this road wasn't here. It was a tote road. It was a lumberman's tote road. Full of stumpage, winter road, really. Oh, I gotta show you this here. Up there, up ahead of us, is a great view of Big Spencer Mountain. It's like a big brick wall when you're coming that way. So they left the drive, after the drive went down the river, they didn't follow them. They came back into Ripogenus Lake and Caribou Lake and did some exploring there for a sheldrake or mergansers, for the story, the way Fannie wrote it. And then they stashed the canoe, hid it in the woods, and walked. From that point about by Caribou Lake, Ragged Lake up there, along that lumberman supply road, which was very narrow then, it was only, you know, wagon width wide, for the Teamsters, full of stumpage and rocks. And she goes on about how long those miles felt walking. And now she was carrying her camera equipment because she went to document the drive, and she had glass plates that she wouldn't even trust to let Wilbur carry. She had to carry those herself because she spent a lot of time taking those pictures of the drive. And so they walked this entire route, and all the miles is given in the story. And they walked out, and they stayed one night at Grant Farm, and there was an adventure there, and you can read about that. And she says it was the eve of the place being torn down. That's how bad the buildings and the structures were at that time in 1891. And then the next day, they walked to Cacajo. And then they arrived in Lily Bay, and there were no steamers running because it was not the time of year yet. But they lucked out, and a steamer did arrive. But that steamer wasn't going right back to Greenville. And Manly Hardy was concerned about his life and the life of his daughter, and Webster was no longer with them. He went back, walking all these same miles across this tote road to go back and get his canoe. So now why, I ask you, would he walk them that way to only turn around and go back 20 miles to go get his canoe? You can see we're coming across somebody here on a bike. Looks like they've got a bunch of camp equipment, and they are making some pretty good time. All right, so the hill we're going over here was named for a teamster from the lumbering days. Size Hill gets its name from a man named Size, and only a hill it is, but it has a steep grade going down this northern side. In the early days, when this area was being logged, they used oxen and later horse teams to haul over the winter tote road. Well, Size, he was a lumber teamster, and he was leading an ox-pulled sled loaded with logs down the hill. That team couldn't hold the load back, and Sias was sluiced. Sluiced, of course, is a lumberman's term for getting pinned between the sled and something else. In this case, poor old Sias, he was pinned between his sled and a big yellow birch at the bottom of the hill. Before the tote road was actually improved, it would require 3 days for a four-horse team to haul material over this road that went rambling for 31 miles through the woods from Lily Bay, past Cacajo and Grand Farm, to the proposed dam site, the way we're traveling today. Before the construction crew set out to hauling the 13,000 tons or more of cement and other material over this corduroy road, they first improved it. And when it was all said and done, a news article stated, Great Northern Paper had made over that tote road into one of the finest gravel top turnpikes in all of Maine, built to grade, smooth and hard. Well, even after they pulled the stumps and moved the boulders, the construction team knew they still had a problem, and that was dealing with Sias Hill. You can see by the contour lines, the north side of Sias Hill has a drop about 200 feet in a half of a mile. While that's only a hill and not a problem for today's vehicles, it isn't the most ideal location to run a road, especially when transporting concrete and heavy supplies. So, in order to deal with that hill's grade, trucks and the tow teams that were still in use were attached to a steel cable, a snubbing line. That line was 2,200 feet long, and then men eased those trucks and those sled teams down that road to where it was level. It was about 1,100 feet, so that cable was continuously going around and going back for the next truck or sled team. When they finally had that system all in place, they were running 7-ton trucks a couple of round trips daily to carry the material that they transported by rail to Kineo Station. They ferried that across Moosehead Lake in scows, towed by steamboats, and then transported it by truck, because there still was no road from Greenville up past Lily Bay to Cacajo. To add insult to poor old Sias, maps still don't spell his name right in many cases, and worse, they don't seem to even agree on the road name. You'll see it labeled on maps as Baxter State Park Road,
the Greenville Road, Sias Hill Road, some even say Main Street. Oh, no matter though, it's about as fine a gravel highway as you're going to find in the Maine North Woods, so long as we don't have a wet spring and summer to deal with. Alright, here we are driving over the top of the Ripogenus Dam. I found an article back in the northern from the 1920s, and it stated that the dam is 860 feet long or so, over 90 feet high in the loftiest part, and down at the base 64 feet thick. The roadway here that we're driving over is supposedly about 16 feet wide, and it was supported by concrete piers with a 5 feet overhang.
There was no dam here like this. It was a roll dam. The actual gated dam was back up at Chesuncook. The lumbermen called it Ripogenus. They always used to say there was rarely a man who fell in that survived. So back in that time, the late 1800s, early 1900s, logs would have to go down to reach the main branch of the Penobscot. And it would take all of May, June, and part of July to get down to the main branch of the Penobscot from here. The logs would come in from all the branch drives, and then at Nicketow, which is the meaning of the fork, at the east branch and the west branch into the main branch of the Penobscot, where they would then flow down to the booms at Argyle and Old Town and eventually into the shipyards and the mills down at Bangor and Brewer. Back when Fannie came here, there was no pulpwood going through. It was all long logs. And this was an area infamous for really bad, nasty jams. She set up her camera up along the gorge, and one day she was out here by the dryway. This used to be an island back here, and the water would funnel around it. Now we have the tunnels that feed McKay Station going up around that way. But that was a really bad spot for jams. It's actually where Larry Connors got hung up. She was setting up, and a young lumberman in his late teens came by and set up a fire for her because he figured the lady, who was wearing a red dress and a red hat, must have been cold being out there by the water. So that day, Fannie was on the drive and she was taking pictures. Her guide, Wilbur Webster, was with her. At that point, he was playing bodyguard. And she knew something was up because he was carrying a gun. And she asked him, "Why the gun, Wilbur?" And he said, "Bears." And she wrote, "The girl's not afraid of bears. It's particularly in June, this time of year. And there are 200 men running around along the river, breaking jams, yelling and screaming and swearing." So Cornelius Murphy, who was hosting Fannie that year here on the drive, sent two men from the West Branch Drive up to Harrington Lake to send Jack Russell a message. He told him, "Russell, the beef is no longer with just Fannie and her father. The whole drive is now against you and protecting you." So supposedly he took that to heart and left her alone that day. So while it was Cornelius Murphy who gave Fannie the tour that day and hosted her, he was working for John Ross that year. And Fannie dedicated the book to John Ross and the West Branch Drive, all the men, for protecting her, and she thanked them, and she felt that she had a debt to them for what they did to protect her and her father from that renegade poacher, Jack Russell. And it's because Fannie was such a wonderful historian that she got to the heart of the men, the Penobscot men, the risks they took, the daring life they led, and sometimes when they ran pitches or falls or rapids, it was simply because of Penobscot pride and had nothing to do with breaking a jam. So those stories are just raw form
of what she found when she came out here, the only woman to camp with a river drive. And back in the 1890s, that was kind of unheard of. This wasn't a grand farm or Chesuncook farm or Piston farm where there was a lumber depot. This was a moving drive that went down the river, and she stayed with them for several days. So she really got to know the men and their stories, and she interviewed them there on the drive and years later while she was preparing the manuscript for that book. It's probably one of the best accounts ever of river driving stories and Maine river history. So there's a lumberman's tale that dead lumbermen come back as Canada Jays. You may know them as Whiskey Jack, Gorbies, camp robbers. They will steal everything from bacon to soap from your campsite. And when Fannie came here, she was wearing a red hat. But when Cornelius Murphy spotted that red hat from where he was up on the gorge, supposedly he got a little spooked because there was one lumberman who didn't come back as a Gorby. Supposedly he came back as a pileated woodpecker, or as the lumbermen call them, the logcock, a terribly able bird of the woods. Well, Larry Connors always wore something red on his head, so Cornelius, seeing that red hat way off in the distance, was kind of spooked about it. And while I was here, this pileated woodpecker was calling and pecking away and drumming on a tree. So I wonder if that was old Larry Connors himself. I also saw this snake along the trail. That, I think, was Jack Russell. Thanks for coming along to explore this area of Ripogenus Gorge and the lumbering history in part one of this episode. If you like the video, please give it a thumbs up and share it, as it really helps the YouTube algorithm and people discovering this channel. And if you haven't yet subscribed to My Main Manage, you'll want to do that now, because in part two of the Ripogenus Gorge episode, we're going to explore here at the McKay Station and also go down to the Chesuncook Boomhouse. You're not going to want to miss it. I'll also share with you the rest of the story about Larry Connors and what happened to him and how they found him, or what was left of him anyway. Oh, and remember, when you're going exploring, sometimes half the fun is just getting there. I'm Tommy Carbone, and you're watching My Main Matters. I'll see you on the trail or on the next episode.